Thank you very much for giving me the chance to be here with you and discuss and argue, actually, why new technologies will not reduce scarcities, and then shed light on the contours of an emerging mode of production. So, in a book titled Why Can We All Just Get Along? MIT scientists Lieberman and Fry discuss why we have wars, mass poverty, and other social ills. They argue that we cannot cooperate to solve our major problems because our institutions are saturated with a competitive spirit. But Lieberman and Fry have some good news. Technologies, new technologies, modern technologies, can solve the root of the problem. They believe that we compete when there is scarcity, and that recent technological advances, such as 3D printing and artificial intelligence, will end widespread scarcity. Hence, a post-scarcity world premised on cooperation would emerge. But can we really end scarcity? I believe that the post-scarcity vision of the world is problematic because it reflects an understanding of technology that could worsen the problems it seeks to address. And this is the bad news. Modern technologies come to consumers, to us, as finished products that can be exchanged for money. However, this may hide the fact that many of these technologies exist at the expense of local environments and other human beings. So, the scarcities experienced by some are linked to the abundance enjoyed by a few. Moreover, many people believe that more efficient technologies can address the problem of scarcities. The Jevons paradox is a key finding attributed to the 19th century economist Stanley Jevons. The Jevons paradox illustrates the negative consequences of improving the efficiency of modern technologies, or actually of improving the efficiency through modern technologies. For example, more efficient train engines allowed for cheaper transportation that catalyzed the Industrial Revolution. However, this did not reduce the rate of fossil fuel consumption. Rather, it increased it. So, we may have more efficient technologies that that use less energy, so they cost less, which often encourages us to use them more, resulting in a net increase in energy consumption. That is why global energy use and global material use have increased threefold since the 1970s. In 2012, a group of scientists ran a sophisticated computer model that predicted what would happen to resource consumption, to resource use, if the economic growth continued on its current trajectory, meaning increasing at a rate of 2 to 3% per year. They found that human consumption of natural resources would rise to 180 billion metric tons per year by 2050. For reference, a sustainable level of resource use is about 50 million metric tons per year. And this limit was surpassed in early 2000s. The scientists rerun this sophisticated computer model, and they assumed an unfortunately very unlikely scenario that every nation on the earth immediately adopted best practices with regards to efficient use of natural resources. Of course, the results improved. Human consumption of natural resources would rise to 93 billion metric tons per year by 2050, but still, this is almost double than the sustainable level of resource use, which is about 50 billion metric tons per year. Yeah. Yeah. This is just an indicative paper. There are many studies that use different methodologies, and this was actually what I was going to say right now, that this is a representative paper. The authors, the first author is Diedrich. So Diedrich 2012, Diedrich et al. Is the citation of this paper, but actually there are a lot of papers that differ, that use different methodologies, and more or less study after study shows that there are physical limits to how efficiently we can use the natural resources. So I don't remember by heart the methodology of this paper, but I just saw this paper because it is more, it is actually one of the most prominent studies in the field. So we can talk afterwards, and I can point you to this paper and also to other papers, also from the United Nations Environment Program, which more or less reached the same conclusion that there are physical limits to how efficiently we can use the natural resources, energy and material. But the good news is that there are alternatives. The wide availability of networked computers has given rise to new models, new open source models of production, such as, for example, the case of Wikipedia, that has displaced the Britannica Encyclopedia and the Microsoft Encarta Encyclopedia, or in the realm of software, the GNU Linux that on which the top 500 computers run, or the Apache web server, which is the leading software in the web server market. So Wikipedia, Apache, and GNU Linux demonstrate how non-coercive cooperation around globally shared resources, that is to say around a commons or a global digital commons, how this kind of cooperation can produce artifacts as innovative, if not more, than the artifacts produced by industrial capitalism. In the same way, the emergence of new, networked microfactories is giving rise to new models of production in the realm of manufacturing. So I will give an example here. Amputees are often disappointed at the high cost of buying and maintaining their prosthetic devices. This is a design of a prosthetic hand created by geographically distributed communities of scientists, designers and enthusiasts. All the knowledge, software and designs related to the manufacturing of such a hand are shared around the globe as a digital commons. Therefore, anyone with internet connection and with access to local manufacturing technologies, such as a low-cost 3D printer, can customize and build such a hand. Another example. Small-scale farmers rarely find appropriate machinery to support their work. Big corporations most of the times produce agricultural machines for large-scale farming. And when they produce machines for small-scale farming, the farmer has to adjust her or his farmer techniques into the logic of the machine. So a community of small-scale farmers in France has designed and manufactured its own agricultural machines. This community shares its designs with the world as a digital commons. Another community from the US has done the same. So these two communities have connected and created synergies by improving the same digital commons. A third example. People of Mitial, which is a rural community in southwest Nepal, needed to electrify their local health clinic. So they connected with national and international communities, open source communities that are interested in small scale wind turbines. Together with access to local manufacturing technologies and local materials, they built a small scale off-grid wind turbine. Training workshops also took place so that the Mitial people become capable of maintaining the infrastructure themselves. So last summer, I was awarded a 4-year grant by the European Research Council to explore an emerging mode of production that builds on the convergence of digital commons with local manufacturing technologies. Such technologies can be found in places, in community-driven places, such as maker spaces or fab labs. This emerging mode of production can be understood as DGML, design global, manufacture local. Put simply, DGML follows the logic that what is light, knowledge, becomes global, and what is heavy, machinery, is local and shared. So this allows for the consideration of the scarcities posed by finite resources and for organizing the production according to participant-defined value systems. The acronym of this 4-year research project is cosmolocalism. Cosmolocalism comes partly from cosmopolitanism. Cosmopolitanism asserts that all human beings belong to a single community based on a shared morality and a shared future. Cosmolocalism captures the potentials of the global digital commons in conjunction with the capacity for more localized manufacturing. So the shared morality in cosmolocalism comes through the commons, through commoning, that is to say, through co-creating and co-managing shared resources. There is a rich and growing ecosystem of DGML products, projects, from design global, manufacture local projects. The WikiHouse initiative, the WikiHouse community that produces open source designs for houses. The LibreSpace community that built the first open source satellite in orbit. Or the RepRap community that creates 3D printers that can self-replicate. Around these digital commons, we're also observing the emergence of new commons-based entrepreneurial ecosystems. So the profit motive is not totally absent, but it is relegated to being a peripheral concept only. However, the claims for the sustainability, innovation, and democratization potential of DGML, of design global manufacture local, rest on thin conceptual and empirical foundations. So the first objective of cosmolocalism, of this research project, is to explore the environmental sustainability of DGML projects. What is the ecological footprint of a product that has been globally designed and locally manufactured vis-a-vis a similar product of conventional industrial production? Or how well does this product fit into the existing natural and cultural environment of its application? The second objective is about the organizational and cultural landscape of DGML projects. What are the values, the governance mechanisms, and the business models of such projects? Third, we will study the DGML innovation systems by asking what can the state and the market learn in order to build more inclusive, smart, and sustainable institutions for innovation. DGML is an emerging phenomenon, thus the case study approach will be followed using a combination of qualitative and quantitative tools, from interviews to participatory action research to life cycle assessment. Especially with regards to the, participatory action research phase of this project, it might be of interest a pilot that is going to take place within this project. So we will connect three local communities of small-scale farmers, one community from Greece, another community from Sierra Leone in Africa, and a third community from Bhutan, Asia. So these three communities, each of these three communities will have access to a local makerspace. We will have these three communities collaborate on the design level of their open source agricultural machines, while these communities will manufacture locally the respective open source agricultural machines using local materials and by adjusting these technologies to the local conditions. Moreover, these three communities will be connected with a global network of open source, of communities that are creating open source agricultural machines. So you can see here this cosmolocal kind of cooperation. And we may argue that if this cosmolocal cooperation works, then this asynchronous, collaborative, open design of technologies that can be locally manufactured could also expand to any field of human expression, of human creativity. So the aim, in all, the aim of cosmolocalism is to advance our understanding of how to create a sustainable economy and society through the commons. Thank you. So I had a short presentation so that we can have a discussion, because this is actually a work in progress. And I think that especially the learning aspect is pervasive to any kind of activity that will take place within this research project.
The more commercial, the more entrepreneurial activity happens at the local level. Is that sort of what you're thinking?
Yes, this may be one part of the story. I mean, there are business models that have also a local orientation and a global orientation. So to discuss about what you are bringing to the discussion, one should adopt a case-by-case approach. It depends on what kind of, for instance, the WikiHouse project has a global orientation. The REPA project has a global and local orientation. The REPA project is the one with 3D printers.
Skill set, expertise, access to materials, to be able to efficiently translate a global design into some kind of efficient local machine.
Yeah. Thank you. First, one should consider that I come from the EU, meaning from a context where the state, we are used to have the state intervene in the public affairs. So in the EU context, one of the preliminary policy proposals that we have is that the state, not only the central state, but maybe the local municipality, should support public maker spaces where people, engineers, educators, you know, interdisciplinary teams of people with such background will be employed and paid by the state. So that, I mean, the presence and the involvement of an expert, it is key. Of course, if you build, for instance, something like a cup, you may not need an expert. But if you build the prosthetic hand, the presence of the expert is necessary. So we think that the state should adopt a pre-distributionist approach, meaning to provide the people, to provide to the creative civil society access to the basic means of production, which is the infrastructure, equipment, and the human capital, the people. Yeah.
Once you manufacture a device in a makerspace, let's say in a town in Greece, or anywhere, and a bunch, you know, say five people from the community paired with the experts of the manufacturing hub or the makerspace, and you see that there's an opportunity to sell 500 of those in your greater region, and to make a business out of that, how would you envision, you know, going from the makerspace of the first copy or the first, you know, prototype to actually being in business, selling a product for profit that was designed by this commons? What are the typical transactional agreements that you would put in place?
Yeah.
Have you thought about that?
Yeah. So again, this is context specific. So I can speak, for instance, about the makerspace that we have in my city, Ioannina, in Greece, where the idea is that if such a product is developed by a citizen or by a community of citizens using the local infrastructure, then the makerspace itself will become partner in, for example, a cooperative that would be a spin-off of such an initiative. And that is a way, for instance, to make these public maker spaces sustainable in the long term. Now, with regards to the licensing, etc., now, again, this depends on what product we are talking about and on the business model. I mean, we have a lot of hybrid business models here, and the aim of this project is to document even more, because as, for instance, is the case in modern capitalism, we don't have only business models, we have a lot of business models. So in the same way that I cannot provide a convincing or an all-inclusive answer to with regards to a traditional business model, you know, in today capitalism, in the same way I cannot provide an all-inclusive answer about a business model that would make profit, but would not maximize profits. So this difference is key. Thank you. Yep. Yeah, so first, I think there are at least three aspects or three positive dynamics with regards to sustainability. The first is the fact that the manufacturing is localized. So you have less transportation of materials. Second is that these communities do not have the motive to produce for obsolescence. I mean, we have observed that there is no planned obsolescence within these products. because these products are primarily created by the communities to last as long as possible. So if the creator of this product does not have the incentive to maximize profits, then we may assume still that's something to be investigated with robust data. We assume that the creative community will design a product so that it lasts as possible. And the third aspect is the fact that we mutualize productive infrastructures. So the idea here is not that every citizen has a 3D printer in his garage and he, you know, just produces stuff, but we share. So instead of having four different productive facilities, four different plants, let's say small scale plants, we have one. So transportation, less transportation, no incentive for plant obsolescence, and sharing of resources, or at least the tangible resources and the intangible resources.
Are there institutions that exist in Sierra Leone, China, or Greece that you think could support these sorts of initiatives, such that these programs are being built in a way that's actually, not just becoming like a lecture program where an expert comes in and says, okay, yeah, I'll do it.
Yeah, we have been thinking about that. The problem here is that I don't have an educational background, meaning I haven't studied the different approaches and schools with regards to education. So we have been, first, our starting point is the educational approach of Ivan Illich. He's a scholar that has written extensively about, against traditional education that follows or reflects the factory standard. You have classrooms and classes taking place organized in the same fashion as you have the production within a factory. So Ivan Illich is a name, but as I said before, because of this weakness that we have as a team, we have been trying to connect with other teams that are more expert with regards to education, such as the MIT D Lab here, that are developing an approach to creative capacity building, P2P University, as you very well know.
Resource is a common structure, right? But the use of a fab lab or a maker space seems to be a step forward, right? In terms of how do you bring the local community and the businesses in absent any formal program? Have you thought about models to do that?
You mean so that we could...
So it's viewed as rather than a specialized facility that needs some specific set of formal programming.
Yeah.
Learning, right?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. First, by saying Fab Lab or Makerspace, we are more inclusive. I mean, we do not only include, we do not only refer to digital fabrication technologies, which are high tech tools, but also to low technologies, the traditional crafts, etc. Now, this was just to clarify, you know, what I understand at least by saying makerspace or Fab Lab. As I said before, our preliminary policy proposal is for public makerspaces. So if we have public makerspaces, in my city, for instance, We are discussing with the local municipality to create such a public maker space. Where are the schools, for instance, the students, the high school students, the students of primary schools, etc., could use the facilities and take part in educational scenarios that have already been developed, that bridge STEMs with humanities, etc. So if we first involve students of any age, and also students of adult education, we think that this can be a crucial step towards the wider inclusion that I think you are implying.
Kind of tries to support is this notion of new cooperativism.
Yeah.
And cooperation seems to be really antagonistic to the existing hierarchical structures that we live in, right? So we talked about everyone wants to be boss, right? You want to be a boss and not an employee. And the employer-employee relationship is really the foundation of a lot of our systems, whereas this seems to be more kind of flattening that out and redesigning the relationship between workers, you know, between colleagues and peers, which is kind of prior, maybe in the Middle Ages was like that, I don't know, artisans, et cetera. What are you envisioning the process of migration towards this more cooperative world? And what are the kind of the major roadblocks that you foresee coming at you as you kind of progress in this thinking? Because there's a lot of people that want to be boss, and that want to continue to be boss. And that's driving us towards the cliff, for sure. How do you, you know, what are the mitigating strategies that you're thinking about? Because you're going to face tremendous opposition.
Yeah, sure. So first, I would like to clarify that I don't argue for a total flat way of organization, because I think that this is unattainable. I think that hierarchies will always exist, but you can have different sorts of hierarchies. For instance, that's why during my talk, I said that in such initiatives, we are observing that the emergence of participant-defined value systems. So this means that organizations emerge out of this model that have hierarchies. But these hierarchies have been decided by every member of the community. Because there are communities that have different value systems. I mean, how I understand value, how I understand, I define what is valuable and what is not valuable, it may be different what my understanding is than your understanding. The issue is if we cooperate to agree on a common denominator on what is valuable to us. And maybe hierarchies will come out of it because we need to handle the issues. But maybe a new kind of hierarchies will emerge that we call for now heterarchies, meaning you have dynamic hierarchies depending on what issue or what task is at stake, what we want to achieve. And this is what we have been at least preliminary observing in these communities. Now, if someone wants to become a boss, and within her or his community, it is impossible to agree on a common denominator with regards to what is valuable, to what is valuable. And what kind of governance mechanisms the respective organization will adopt, he or she may even create a typical, you know, a traditional company, or even become an autonomous worker. But the idea is that the obstacle of entry and the obstacle of exit from such an organization is low, so that you can be really dynamic and and self-aggregate or actually to have a sense of autonomy with regards to where you will be involved or not. Now, the most important roadblocks or obstacles will come from, you know, the existing power structures. Oh, this is a long story. Yeah. From the established, the nested interest, et cetera. Yeah, this is going to be huge. Yeah.
Just a few more thoughts. It's really at its beginning stages.
Yeah, but definitely.
It also looks like all the resources that you need to do this are already there, and that you have, you know, a communications network, and you have, you know, distributed functional societies across the globe. So it's not as if it's impossible to do.
Yeah.
And it seems that it has the potential to really subvert the current business climate, which we would have to call capitalism, and maybe even exist in tandem with it, but eventually subvert it, you know, and perhaps be the seed that brings down the structure of these huge, bloated companies that do have built obsolescence into them, which is unsustainable in a small planet that we have. So I can see the potential for this to solve a lot of big problems, but I think it needs some kind of seed energy to get started, and maybe that's what you're thinking of. Maybe educational or mini grants to kind of like get it off the ground. And then it will sort of, it may feed off itself the way Wikipedia fed off itself and started out with, you know, 200 entries, and now look at it. You know, this could feed off itself with enough initial impetus. What do you, any comments about that or?
I definitely share your view. I come here, unfortunately, with very few answers to your questions, because this is the questions that we have already posed. And, you know, we are just at the beginning of trying to address them. But as a classical European, I believe that the role of the state is key here. As, for instance, is the case here in the States with regards to innovation, the state intervention is high here in the States, although it may not seem. But for instance, look at the iPhone. Almost 90% of the innovations that are crystallized on the iPhone, they have been funded by state money. So the state has been really supportive, but not with regards to healthcare, not with regards to social benefits, but with regards to innovation. I think, at least this is what we say in Europe, that your public discourse here in the States is the Jeffersonian, but the real practice with regards to research and design is Hamiltonian, meaning that the state intervenes, although it may not seem, but it intervenes. And maybe this paradigm could be a new field, a new platform, or a new area of state intervention, so that the state, as I said before, provides support, as for instance, Wikimedia. What does Wikimedia? Wikimedia sustains the productive infrastructure of Wikipedia. The Wikimedia Foundation is like the mini state of the Wikipedia ecosystem. So if you start from this micro scale to the macro scale, one may say that what Wikimedia is for the Wikipedia ecosystem, the state can be for this ecosystem, so that this ecosystem can scale up.
Know where you're at with it. That would be really.
Yeah, let's hope that we will have some encouraging results. But anyway, thank you.
It's related. I was wondering if you could speak a bit about where you are now in terms of, do you have staff positions to fill? Are there volunteer networks that you're trying to tap into? Like when you think about 6 months from now or 1 year from now, where are your team's energies being put in terms of trying to build a movement of either paid folks you're working with, or just communities that you want to sort of buy into the idea?
Yeah, actually, thank you. Actually, right now, we are hiring. We have created a team, or we will create a team in the next 2 months of nine researchers. One researcher will come from Bhutan, and hopefully the other one from Sierra Leone, so that we have a liaison to these countries. We will need, I think, at least 3 months to clearly formulate our next research steps. And right now we are trying to create connections with local communities in these three countries, Greece, Bhutan, and Sierra Leone. And also, and this is one of the main reasons why I'm here, we're trying also to create connections with teams from Cambridge and from the MIT and Harvard that would be interested in collaborate with us and research things that we cannot research, as for instance, it concerns education. And after we have a clear understanding of the model that we propagate, we hope that we will you know, open this project also to the world so that we can work with volunteers or whatever. So I think that the first tangible and essential results will come after 2 years or 1 year and a half, the first. Yeah, thank you.
Get groups that you have, these, like, are you only looking at country at areas in like developing countries? Do you have a specific idea of economies of scale where things kind of stop being replicable in this model, as well as what kinds of products are most useful from like a quality control standpoint? Like,
yeah.
If you do have a strong state presence, what is the state's presence if not to?
Just a minute. So this provides a bird's eye view on the structure and the working packages of this research. So in this working package, and through the synthesis of these two, we will study different sectors, a wide array of sectors with regards to DGML projects. So wind turbines, with regards to energy, 3D printers, DGML 3D printers, DGML satellites, DGML wind turbines, DGML prosthetics, DGML houses, what else? DGML sensors and devices that can be used in this so-called Internet of Things. So the idea is that we study and we get a good understanding of the values, the business models of successful projects. And then we will go to the local communities, that are interested in using open source agricultural machines, so farming communities, but the machines, the tools I aforementioned, can also have complementary use in communities of this working package that are farming communities. For instance, in the local community in Greece, which is our target group, it is a community on the mountains. So it is a very, it is one of the poorest communities in Greece, on the mountains. And first they needed internet connection. Because if you have, for instance, if you want to build a smart beehive, there is a DGML smart beehive. This beehive should be connected to the web, to the internet, but they didn't have internet. So we also developed DGML community Wi-Fi. They needed also electrical energy. We are actually on the process of building DGML wind turbines, so that we have this agricultural machine, in this case, an open source beehive, smart beehive, to have it connected to the web and to make sure that it has enough energy. So the reply to your question is that we will investigate various projects from various sectors of economic activity, and then we will see how all this knowledge that will have been accumulated from, you know, global research of the state of the art with regards to DGML, how this accumulated knowledge can be translated into meaningful social impact locally in three very vulnerable local communities. Greece, Africa, and Europe, Greece especially, Sierra Leone, and Bhutan. And we chose on purpose poor countries because we would like to have some extreme cases and test this model to its, you know, to a very difficult condition. And we may argue that if this model can address some serious problems in such extreme cases, then one may say this model can also work in cases that are less extreme. Thank you. Thank you for the question.